I just want you guys to get to know him a little bit. Tell me about your family and about where you grew up.
But, you know, my dad was in the Air Force, and my mom was an American school teacher, so we lived all over the place. I was born in Columbus, Ohio, then moved from there to Okinawa, Japan. Was there for a couple of years, then to Arizona, then over to Germany, a few different places in Germany, back to Colorado, back to Germany.
An Army brat, in other words.
Yeah, he was in the Air Force. And so I went to high school over in Würzburg, Germany. Graduated from Würzburg American High School, and I went to play junior college basketball in Arizona, then transferred to University of San Diego and finished up my 4-year there.
All right, there you go.
We got a Torero out there, huh? Go Toreros.
Hey, yeah. Let me ask you a question. All those exotic places. What, you know? And obviously your memory is a little different, you know, because when you're small and you're growing up, what stood out the most? Which of those places hold some special memories to you?
Well, Germany does, because we were in, I think, 3 different locations in Germany, you know, elementary school, high school. The only time I wasn't overseas was in middle school. So just being over there and experiencing the different cultures, you know, here in the States, people, when they go on their spring break, they may go down to the beach or down to San Diego or maybe down to Tijuana. You know, in Germany, our spring break vacation was to Spain or to Italy or Switzerland or something like that. And so just having access to the different countries and different cultures growing up really helped shape who I am.
Do you speak German?
No, I used to speak it.
Okay, I was
going to
say, because you could get on Dirk, real, real nice and real personable if you needed to do that. And then, how about as a player, as a basketball player? How were you?
Not good.
How would you describe yourself?
Kind of hard nosed utility guard. Just do whatever I need to do, get it done. I felt like I was always a leader. I set solid screens. I could shoot if I was open and try to run the offense, do what coach said, and then play good D.
Tell us more about your family a little bit. Your direct family.
I have one brother and 2 sisters. Again, an older sister.
Are they around here? Are they in Ohio? Or where are they?
Well, my parents plus both my sisters and their families live in San Antonio. When I was with the Spurs for 3 years from 2000 to 2003, they had an opportunity to visit myself, my wife, and our 2 boys down there, and they've kind of fell in love with it. Plus, it's a military area, too. So with all the bases and all that, they ended up moving down there. My older sister works for USAA. My younger sister, who's a baby of the family, she was just out here for the last few games with her family. She's a stay-at-home mom. And then my younger brother, he played 5 years in the NFL, and he's a U.S. Marshal right now.
So there you go, like Tommy Lee Jones in The Fugitive, which is a great movie, by the way. How's that military background translated into your coaching and into your organizational skills? I'm assuming it's huge as far as what you've got going right now in with your job.
Well, my dad was very disciplined, and he was regimented in terms of his schedule and stuff like that, and how he prepared for his job and what he did for to have success at his job or his workplace. And so I picked up, I think, on a lot of those things, or at least I hope I did. And I feel like I always prepare myself as best possible to for any task at hand, and I try to make sure that everything is orderly and so on and so forth.
Hey, by the way, what are the odds that his voice doesn't make it through the season? You know what I'm saying? Because it's, yeah. What about the guys were joking about it. You put in a lot of work, don't you? You know, give me an example of a day with the Lakers staff, and you've got a huge staff, guys, real capable guys, all different ages, different kind of personalities. Kind of give the folks a sense of literally how much time and effort you guys are putting in each and every day to Laker basketball.
I got a great staff, and we got guys that are dedicated to trying to help us get better on a daily basis. I mean, I have guys on my staff that stay the night in the office and stuff like that. And
you do. You have like cots in the office now, don't you?
We do. We want to try to prepare our guys as best as possible and to try to get better as soon as possible and to win games. So we have some hard, dedicated guys that are working on the Lakers staff, which is very fun to be around.
You know, I want to give you guys, you know, since it's all access, I hope the coach can give you some insight on some real basketball-oriented things since you played the zone against Dallas. Do you think the Lakers will play a little bit more zone now in the future? I mean, is it something that you're actively looking to maybe get these guys involved with a little bit more?
When the lockout was going on, that was part of what we talked about as a staff. We came up with a zone package, and we have principles and all that stuff that we want to talk to the guys about and apply in a 3-2 zone, but we just haven't had the time. And, since training camp, we haven't had a live practice. So it's been almost impossible for us to work on that while we're trying to get to the other things that we need to get to.
It seems like you're still trying to work on your rotation. How do you dole out playing time? Is it a feel thing? Do guys earn it in practice? Is it what happened in the next game? I'm interested to see how guys all of a sudden are in the lineup and playing more minutes than maybe they were sitting for a couple of games.
It's a combination of all of the above, and including a feel, including what they've done in the previous games. Earlier in the season, it was including what they did in training camp and the two preseason games. And, the tough thing about the lockout this year, we had a terrific training camp. We had some D-League guys that we invited to camp that, deserved more of a look than what they got, because I thought they were pretty good, and I thought some of them were NBA players. But because the preseason and the training camp was shortened, it was kind of sort of unfair to them to where I couldn't play them. I couldn't sacrifice any minutes for those guys in the preseason game to take a good look at them. And so it's no different with the rest of the roster that we have. I kind of had to play guys a certain amount of minutes and had to make a decision based on the short amount of time that I was around them. And as these games go on, you continue to get a better feel of which combinations may work best.
It's a cliche question, but I know anybody who's still here is interested in this, and you've been asked it, but I'm sure they want to hear it. The LeBron-Kobe thing. What do they do differently? How would you talk about them personality-wise, talent-wise? We're talking two of the best players ever to play this game on the planet, and you've had a chance now to coach them both. Let's go. You've seen Kobe now for 3 weeks regular season. Differences, personality-wise and on the basketball floor?
Personality-wise, they're both good guys. The one thing about LeBron that's different than Kobe, LeBron likes to have a ton of people around him all the time. It's almost like he's in high school or in college. He's in college, and he'd prefer to live in the frat house with, 15, 16 of his buddies, and everything that he does includes all of his buddies all the time. And Kobe's probably the opposite. Kobe is a guy that people would say, if he was in college, is probably more is mature beyond his years. Is a guy that may go watch a movie by himself or go watch a movie with a friend or two and keep his group real small. And so he's more business. He's more businesslike than LeBron. But both those guys are competitive and they both want to win.
Kobe said that he's enjoying the working relationship with you because you put in so much time, and that's him. He's work. Let's Kobe. Let's work. What's the harshest thing you've said to Kobe so far? What's the harshest thing you've had to reprimand him for on the basketball floor in practice yet? And how's he taken to that?
The biggest thing is probably gambling defensively in the backcourt. He's a very good steal guy. And, I'm not big on steals. And I always feel if you go for a steal and you miss it, you really hurt your team. And so that's happened a couple of times. And I've had to take a couple of timeouts just to remind him not to do that.
What's the fine line on, man, you got to carry us, and, man, you got to pass the ball kind of a thing?
There is that fine line, and it's just based on feel, and we've had this conversation numerous times. I believe, coach him in a short amount of time and just watch him in practice and in these games. Even at his age now, he could average over 40 points a game. This is the truth. This man can average over 40 points a game if he wanted to. The tough part about it is, in the game of basketball, if you have a guy that's averaging that many points and you have other good players around you, then it's tough because those guys sometimes they get to standing or they may get disinterested or they may rely too much on Kobe, and I can't have that happen because come playoff time, you're going to face some pretty good defensive teams. And if a guy carries you there averaging 40-plus and you're facing good defensive teams and they scheme against him and guys aren't used to scoring or knowing how to score in tough situations, and you're going to run into some problems come playoff time.
Hey, try to tell everybody, give them kind of a sneak peek. Like when we're watching the game on Thursday, and you're going up against Miami. Offensively, what should the folks watch that is not like a normal thing? Take them inside something. When you're on the offensive end going against the Miami defense, you know, so they know, hey, the Lakers are running this right or they're not, or they can take advantage of this matchup. What's something that they can look for on Thursday when the Lakers have the basketball?
Well, the biggest thing that Miami does, they use their athleticism and their quickness and their aggressiveness. So they will trap us. They will pick us up full court at times. And so we're going to have to do a good job of two things. Our spacing is going to have to be very good.
Explain spacing a little bit to everybody.
Generally, you don't want anybody on the floor, at least, you know, unless it happens quickly, you don't want anybody on the floor 15 feet or closer together. Because now if you start to creep close to one another, or if you get inside that 15-foot barrier, now we say one guy can guard two. So if you and I are sitting right here and this coffee table was a defender, well, obviously he can guard both of us because our spacing is poor. So we need to be about 15 feet apart. So now he has to make a decision, especially when the ball is passed, of who he has to go cover. And if you can have one guy guard the two of us right here, that means there are three other offensive players out there, four other defensive players out there. And so now those four defensive players can trap and all that other stuff while this one guy guards too. So our spacing is going to have to be very good against that aggressive defensive athletic team. And then we're going to have to make sure that we take care of the ball, too, because if we don't, our bad passes or our turnovers will lead to easy dunks for them in transition.
Has that been just driving you crazy? What is the deal with the turnovers on this team? I mean, there was 27 in one game, and you're averaging up like 16, 17, 18 a game. Why? Why is this team having such a problem?
You know, it goes back to just a new system. I mean, you know, like I said, I put in three new plays 2 days ago, and we ran them a ton yesterday. And, you know, just like anybody else at any other job, if you experience something new, there's a learning curve that you go through in order to perfect it or become to a point where you're pretty good at it. And right now we're not, but we are getting better. So it has a lot to do with that.
You know, defensively, just in general philosophy, you're doing something with the centers. You come out and show them a little bit when they're coming out. They're hedging out a little bit. Explain that philosophy. And against LeBron and against Chris Bosh, against that specific, some things that the fans can look for on the television to take them inside the game.
Defensively, you know, LeBron's a guy that can beat you in a lot of different ways. And if he's going to beat us, hopefully he's going to beat us making jump shots. So we're going to try to give him that 19-footer, especially off the dribble, and contest late to him, as opposed to getting to the rim. If he gets to the rim, he's very, very good. He can finish, obviously, in traffic, but not only can he finish in traffic if he's getting to the rim, he can make plays for his teammates. He's a great facilitator, and that's what he wants to do first before he scores. So we have to make sure that we don't overcommit to him and we don't allow him to get into the lane all the time. And that's what our defense is. We want to make sure that lane is crowded by shrinking the floor, almost play as a man, a matchup zone, in essence. And if we could do that, then we'll be in pretty good shape. And in pick and roll situations, we don't want to play pick and roll soft with our bigs all the time. We want to make sure that our bigs have the ability to defend pick and roll soft, but they also can defend it in an aggressive manner, which when that ball handler comes off a pick and roll, our bigs can jump out there and attack the ball and put pressure on their ball handler so they can't make plays in the pick and roll game.
How's Darius Morris coming along? And what are you working on him, with him specifically? Because point guard is so important, and with Steve Blake out for two or three more weeks, you know, Darius is going to have to play some minutes, like about 20, 24 minutes a game. What are you working on with him?
Well, the biggest thing with Darius, I don't try to feed him too much because, you know, he's a rookie. And yeah. He's an.
You're playing rookies. Phil would never play rookies. Ever.
Yeah. Well, you know, we got some talented ones. So, yeah. I don't want to give him too much. I don't want his computer to overheat. So I just, for the most part, want him to go play. But the one thing that I think he can get better on that will help him out and us out in the long run is a little floater game, because he's got great size, he's got great quickness, he can get into the paint, but I don't know if you guys recall, when he gets into the paint, a lot of times he picks his dribble up. He has nowhere to go with the basketball because everybody's 7 foot that's starting to surround him, and everybody's quick and they react to him or to his dribble penetration better than what he expects. And so, you know, we told him, young fellow, when you get into the paint, just throw it up there. And if you can get to a point where you at least know what a runner is and know how to get a runner off, now those 7-footers that step up and try to block it, if you can get it over their outstretched hands, then you will get an assist off an offensive rebound, because we'll have guys on the backside that can rebound that basketball when their man steps up to block a shot. So, you know, Quinn Snyder right now is taking the task on of trying to help Darius to develop a runner so that he's a little bit more effective when he gets into the paint for us.
Hey, Mike, to you and your staff, who's the guy that you guys have all gotten together, you look at each other, you've been shaking your head going, this guy's really doing a job for us. Surprised you maybe a little bit, worked a little bit harder, come out of his, you know, come into his own, had kind of a breakout year. Could be a guy who's already been a starter or a new guy. Who's the guy that's really jumped out at all of you guys as a staff?
You know what, I tell you what, a lot of guys have. You know, you could talk about Andrew Bynum and getting the type of double-doubles that he has gotten. You know, we felt that he was a double-double guy, but some of the numbers at times that he pulls down in terms of 22 and 17, you know, we didn't imagine that. I felt he was a double-double guy, but I wasn't quite sure what the numbers are. And as soon as we could figure out and he can figure out how to continually attack the double teams and the fake double teams that he's getting and making the teams pay on the backside, he will be a monster scorer because he is extremely skilled, extremely long, and very agile. But I can go on and on. I think Matt Barnes is doing a heck of a job for us too. You know, he's done a nice job, especially defensively, bringing energy to us, just making hustle plays and running the floor, doing the little things that I felt that starting group needed to have something that's different in the lineup. You know, so you can say Matt, you can say Darius, because he was not expected to play this year, and he's gotten thrown into the fire and he's responded well. So I can go on and on about the different guys on the team that have kind of stepped up and done some things that we weren't quite expecting at the beginning of the year.
A couple more things. How'd you like your little dalliance in television? Your year away from it. How did that year away from the game and being involved with TV kind of re-energize you? What did you think of your TV experience? How do you think you did?
I thought I did okay. It was fun because I got to experience the game from a different aspect, from another level. And so being able to experience it from a media perspective opened my eyes to some things. But for me, more importantly, what that year off did, it allowed me to reconnect with my two boys and spend some time with them. But just as important, if not more important, with my wife. You know, my wife has played mother and father to my boys for a lot of years.
Oh, yeah.
because of our schedule, especially during the season. And so to be able to take her to the movies or take her to dinner without thinking about, you know, why we lost the last game or what we're going to do in practice tomorrow or what we're going to do the next game was a good time.
Very proud papa here, and he's got two real talented sons who play basketball, modern-day high school. They just got back. I know, just go ahead and tell us about them, because I know you're very proud of them and how's things are going down in modern day for them.
They were back east. They played in a tournament back east at the Hall of Fame in Springfield, Massachusetts. They played Christ the King yesterday, and they did a heck of a job. They were on, matter of fact, they were on ESPNU, so they got a little national TV time, and they beat Christ the King, who's a very good team. They beat them by about 30 or 40. So it was exciting to watch, and to watch those boys, knowing how hard they work, watch it pay off on national TV. But my oldest boy, he plays varsity. He's a junior at Mater Dei, and he's doing very well. He had a good game yesterday. It's Elijah. And then my youngest boy, Cameron, he plays on the freshman basketball team at Mater Dei. But his first love is football, and they had a great freshman year.
Hey, last thing. Tell everybody else what to look forward to for the rest of the year. I mean, because this is a team, everybody wants a championship. I mean, you knew that walked in here. Nothing less than hanging a banner is acceptable almost in Los Angeles.
That's why I'm here.
That's why you're here.
Right.
What are going to be the keys for the next couple months to be able to actually, you know, compete for?
Well, you know, I think right now our guys are doing a pretty good job on the defense end of the floor. They picked up a lot of the concepts. You can see the energy there. You can see the effort there. You can see the communication and the trust the things that you need to see in order to have success on that end of the floor. We just have to continue to trust each other offensively, making sure that the floor is spaced the right way. We're getting the ball from the backcourt to the front court in a timely manner so we can get to our second, our third, our fourth option, and that we continue to be aggressive individually so it will turn into team success, especially as the year gets longer and longer and longer.
Mike, I say for everybody here, thanks for the time. You've been real gracious. I know everybody's dialed in, man. We're ready to go. Let's win some games.
Hey, I appreciate it.